You're listening to the audio production of The 17 Indisputable Laws of Teamwork. Embrace them and empower your team. This abridged audiobook was written by John C. Maxwell, published by HarperCollins Leadership, and read by the author.
Introduction. Every day in some way, you are part of a team. The question is not, will you participate in something that involves others? The question is, will your involvement with others be successful? Everyone knows that teamwork is a good thing. In fact, it's essential. But how does it really work? What makes a winning team? Why do some teams go straight to the top, seeing their vision become reality, while others seem to go nowhere? These questions don't have simple answers. If they did, sports would have more back-to-back world champions, and the list of Fortune 500 companies wouldn't change year after year. One of the challenges of learning about teamwork is that even people who've taken a team to the highest level in their field sometimes have a hard time identifying what separates a great team from a collection of individuals who can't seem to get it together. Some will say the key to winning is a strong work ethic. But haven't you known plenty of hardworking individuals who never work together to reach their potential? Others believe that great teams are the result of chemistry. They often say, "I can't explain how you create it, but I definitely know it when I see it." Now, how can you get your hands around that and learn from it to build your team? As a communicator who spends countless hours speaking to live audiences every year, I'm always looking for straightforward ways to teach people complex truths. That's what a communicator does. He takes something complicated and makes it simple. I want to take the mystery out of it. That's why I've worked hard to identify the laws of teamwork. The wonderful thing about a law is that you can depend on it. No matter who you are, what your background is, or what circumstances you face, you can take a law to the bank. As I teach you the laws, you will find that I often approach the subject of teamwork from a leader's point of view. That makes sense, since leaders are the ones who bring teams together and lead them to victory. But you don't have to be a leader to benefit from these principles. Just about everything you do depends on teamwork. It doesn't matter whether you are a leader or a follower, coach or player, teacher or student, parent or child, CEO or nonprofit volunteer worker. No matter who you are, if you learn and apply the laws, your teamwork capacity will increase. The greater the number of laws that you and your teammates learn, the more likely you are to be transformed from a group of individuals into a winning team. I want to encourage you to devote yourself to the process of learning to be a great team member and team builder. As you learn about the laws of teamwork and begin to apply them, I think you will find that they have a positive impact on every aspect of your life. As you proceed, also remember this: none of the laws stands alone, but they all stand together really well. The greater number of laws you learn, the better you will become as a team member. Enjoy the process. Give it your best. And never forget that no matter what you want to do in life, it takes teamwork to make the dream work. So, let's get started. Law number one, the law of significance. One is too small a number to achieve greatness. First, let me ask you, who are your personal heroes? Okay, maybe you don't have heroes exactly. Then let me ask you this. Which people do you admire most? Who do you wish you were more like? Which people fire you up and get your juices flowing? Do you admire business innovators such as Bill Gates? Great athletes like Michael Jordan? Spiritual leaders, maybe Billy Graham or Mother Teresa? Or maybe you admire revolutionary thinkers such as Thomas Edison or Albert Einstein. Your list might include people in a field I didn't mention. But it's safe to say that we all admire achievers. And we Americans especially love pioneers and bold individualists, people who fight alone despite the odds or opposition. The settler who carves a place for himself in the wilds of the frontier. The Old West sheriff who resolutely faces an enemy in a gunfight. The pilot who bravely flies solo across the Atlantic Ocean. And the scientist who changes the world through the power of his mind. As much as we admire solo achievement, the truth is that no lone individual has done anything of value. The belief that one person can do something great is a myth. There are no real Rambos who can take on a hostile army by themselves. Even the Lone Ranger wasn't really a loner. Everywhere he went, he rode with Tonto. Nothing of significance was ever achieved by an individual acting alone. Look below the surface and you will find that all seemingly solo acts are really team efforts. Frontiersman Daniel Boone had companions from the Transylvania Company as he blazed the Wilderness Road. Sheriff Wyatt Earp had his two brothers and Doc Holliday looking out for him. Aviator Charles Lindbergh had the backing of 9 businessmen from St. Louis and the services of the Ryan Aeronautical Company, which built his plane. Even Albert Einstein, the scientist who revolutionized the world with his theory of relativity, didn't work in a vacuum. Of the debt he owed to others for his work, Einstein once remarked, "Many times a day I realize how much my outer and inner life is built upon the labors of my fellow men, both living and dead, and how earnestly I must exert myself in order to give in return as much as I have received." It's true that the history of our country is marked by those accomplishments of many strong leaders and innovative individuals who took considerable risk, but those people always were a part of a team. A Chinese proverb states that behind an able man, there are always other able men. The truth is that teamwork is at the heart of great achievement. The question isn't whether teams have value. The question is whether we acknowledge that fact and become better team players. If you want to reach your potential or strive for the seemingly impossible, you need to become a team player. It may be a cliche, but it is nonetheless true. Individuals play the game, but teams win championships. Knowing all that we do about the potential of teams, why do people still want to do things by themselves? I believe there are a number of reasons. Number one, ego. Few people are fond of admitting that they can't do everything, yet that is a reality of life. Philanthropist Andrew Carnegie declared, "It marks a big step in your development when you come to realize that other people can help you do a better job than you could do alone. To do something really big, let go of your ego and get ready to be part of a team." Number two, insecurity. In my work with leaders, I have found that some individuals fail to promote teamwork because they feel threatened by other people. I believe that insecurity, rather than poor judgment or lack of intelligence, most often causes leaders to surround themselves with weak people. On the other hand, insecure leaders usually fail to build teams because of one of two reasons. Either they want to maintain control over everything for which they are responsible, or they fear being replaced by someone more capable. In either case, leaders who fail to promote teamwork undermine their own potential and erode the best efforts of the people with whom they work. Number three, being naive. Consultant John Gagan keeps a sign on his desk that says, "If I had it to do all over again, I'd get help." That remark accurately represents the feelings of the third type of people who fail to become team builders. They naively underestimate the difficulty of achieving big things. As a result, they try to go it alone. Number four, temperament. Some people aren't very outgoing and simply don't think in terms of team building and team participation. as they face challenges, it never occurs to them to enlist others to achieve something. As a people person, I find that hard to relate to. Whenever I face any kind of challenge, the very first thing I do is think about the people I want on the team to help with it. I've been that way since I was a kid. I've always thought, why take the journey alone when you can invite others along with you? I understand that not everyone operates that way. But whether or not you are naturally inclined to be part of a team is really irrelevant. If you do everything alone and never partner with other people, you create huge barriers to your own potential. Dr. Alan Fromm quipped, "People have been known to achieve more as a result of working with others than against them." What an understatement. It takes a team to do anything of lasting value. Besides, even the most introverted person in the world can learn to enjoy the benefits of being on a team. A few years ago, my friend Chuck Swindoll wrote a piece in The Finishing Touch that sums up the importance of teamwork. He said, "Nobody is a whole team. We need each other. You need someone, and someone needs you. Isolated islands, we're not. To make this thing called life work, we gotta lean and support, and relate and respond, and give and take, and confess and forgive, and reach out and embrace, and rely. Since none of us is a whole, independent, self-sufficient, super capable, all-powerful hotshot, let's quit acting like we are. Life's lonely enough without our playing that silly role. The game is over. Let's link up." For the person trying to do everything alone, the game really is over. If you want to do something big, you must link up with others. One is too small a number to achieve greatness. That's the law of significance. The teamwork thought for the law of significance is this. You may be good, but you're not that good. Law number two, the law of the big picture. The goal is more important than the role. Years ago, I was invited to participate in an important conference that was being planned by a highly respected national organization. I was one of about a dozen speakers who had been selected to speak to an audience of more than 60,000 people drawn from all parts of the country. Several weeks before the conference was to occur, all the speakers were scheduled to meet together along with the founder of the organization. I was really excited about it because the group included some extraordinary leaders. It promised to be an electric time, but the reality of the meeting turned out to be different from what I expected. As we discussed the upcoming day, a few of the speakers seemed to be jockeying for position. Because they were good communicators, they understood that the speaking order, the time of day, and the amount of time allotted would make a big difference in how their messages would be received. The role each speaker was to play seemed to be of more interest than the goal of the conference. But I also noticed something else. When one speaker briefly informed us about his topic, I sensed immediately that his speech would be the real hinge pin of the whole conference. All of the other messages would be subordinate to it. Yet the man was not fighting for the best place. In that moment, when everyone was focusing on himself, I realized that we had lost sight of the big picture of why we were there. So I said to the group about this speaker, "I believe his message will be the difference maker in the lives of the people attending this conference. And I think the audience will receive it better if it's delivered when I am slated to speak. Please," I said to the person who wasn't trying to promote himself, "take my spot." It was almost as if somebody had struck each person in the room. Suddenly, everybody regained perspective. After that, instead of looking out for themselves and protecting turf, all of the speakers were willing to give everything for the common good. We all remembered that the goal was more important than our individual roles. That is the essence of the law of the big picture. In a culture that sings the praises of individual gold medals, and where a person fights for rights instead of focusing on taking responsibility, people tend to lose sight of the big picture. A team isn't supposed to be a bunch of people being used as a tool by one individual for selfish gain. Members of a team must have mutually beneficial shared goals. They must be motivated to work together, not manipulated by someone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.